Good evening. It's a great pleasure to be here in front of all of you this evening, talking about a topic that's very close to my heart. Talking about entrepreneurship, I think before we get into the topic and talk about entrepreneurship, I think I should start by thanking NPTEL for putting me in front of all of you. But more importantly, I want to thank them because. After 5 weeks of wearing a jockey t-shirt and some old pajamas, actually wearing a nice full shirt, I can tell you I haven't had so much joy ever in wearing a shirt as I've had today. So NPTEL, thank you. On that happy note, let's get started. Today's topic is about entrepreneurship. And what I want to do is, before I get into why I chose this topic and exactly what we are going to talk about, I want to take a couple of minutes to tell you a little bit more about myself, right? So I have about 18 years of experience in the industry. I have a bachelor's, master's and PhD in electrical and computer engineering. And in 2002, some of it in India, some of it in the US. And in 2002, I returned to India after my PhD to join this company called Texas Instruments, where I joined as an analyst. I was there for about 2.5 years at Texas Instruments when some of my colleagues were leaving the company to start an Indian semiconductor company. And the prospect of an Indian semiconductor company sounded so exciting to me that I felt I should do the same, that I should leave and go join them as well. So that was Cosmic Circuit, a company that we all founded in 2005. And it was a great 8-year journey from 2005 until 2013, where we licensed semiconductor IP to a number of leading semiconductor companies around the world. If you have a great technology product today, a phone, display, etc., there's a fair chance that some of the work that we did found its way into the device that you own. So it was a great and very exciting 8 years. And at the end of that 8 years, we were acquired by a company called Cadence Design Systems. Now, if you're an electrical engineer, you have heard the name Cadence or Synopsys is a tool that you probably use in college today. So Cadence Design Systems is another billion-dollar multinational company that acquired Cosmic Circuit. I spent about 3 years at Cadence. And while at Cadence, I started looking at the interesting con. And one of the things that appealed to me was the space of appliances in India. And you think about it a little bit, right? You imagine the gas cylinder, for example, right? For the 40 plus years that I've been around in this world, the gas cylinder has looked exactly the same. And I'm sure if I go to somebody who's 15, 20 years older than me and ask them, they will likely say that even for the gas cylinders looked exactly the same. The same thing can be said for washing machines, conditioners, most things that have had very little change, right? You look around the house, you look at lighting, right? What was a 100 watt bulb 15, 20 years ago has now given way to a 5 watt LED, 20, 25 times improvement in power. Whereas you look at air conditioners or you look at washing machines, the same improvement has in power. So air conditioners used to be about 1200 watts of power 15 years ago, continue to be 900 to 1000 watts even today. This gimmickry in terms you can control with your phone and stuff, but the fundamental design hasn't really gotten a whole lot better. So I started looking at the question of, is it possible to build a cooler that you can wear, that only cools you? Air conditioners take so much power because they're cooling the walls, they're cooling your bed, they're cooling so many things that they probably don't need to cool. So I thought, okay, maybe if I build a wearable cooler, a cooler that somebody can wear and take with them, that could be the right solution, right? And that's how Blue Armor was born. And I'll let you check out Blue Armor later. Now that we're about 3 years into Blue Armor, I've gone through these periods in time where I keep wondering, oh, I wish I had known this before I had started, or I wish I had thought about this problem this way when I was starting, right? And it happened often enough that I thought that it'll be interesting to talk to you about things that you would be that you should know before you take the plunge, why it's important for you to be aware of these factors before you take the plunge. So I'm going to go over a list of things that I think are important, as well as some reasons for why I believe they are. So with that, let's go in. I want to start with this image. And you know, if you're anybody that follows startups in any form, you would be used to seeing news releases that look like this, right? And you know, EOS interprets news in many different ways. For me, the first thing that catches my eye of these three companies that you see put up there, Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, I don't need to tell any of you what these companies do, right? And that's an amazing thing. You mean Facebook was incorporated in 2004, so it's a 15, 16-year-old company. WhatsApp was incorporated in 2009 and Instagram in 2010. So these companies are anywhere between 10 to 15 years old, not very old, right? So imagine for a minute that a 10-year-old company has WhatsApp, has had so much impact that when you talk about the company, you don't need to tell anybody what the company is. It's so obvious to everybody, right? That's the kind of powerful impact that a good startup can have. And personally for me, that's a phenomenal reason to go after entrepreneurship, right? Then there are other things that stand out, you know, the numbers for which they get acquired, the amount of wealth they create, the degree to which they influence lives. And, you know, it's interesting that you see Facebook acquired WhatsApp, Facebook acquired Instagram. Facebook itself is only 15 years old. So in its own right, it's not a very old company. It's a startup that's that went IPO very recently. So the fact that these companies are able to scale to such degrees, impact so lives, is a phenomenal gives phenomenal credibility to what startups are capable of. There's also the example closer home with Flipkart. And you know, again, a very interesting story is maybe a 12-year-old, 13-year-old story now. 2007, 2008 was when they started. And they've been part of that revolution where they've changed how Indians shop, right? And you know, I've heard arguments like, oh, they're just copying somebody else, etc., etc. And I think those arguments are irrelevant. If you can influence people to this degree, then you deserve all the success you're getting. So to me, that there are all these companies that demonstrate such visible success is a great sign of entrepreneurship. So let's sort of take a minute now and capture that in various points and try to answer the question of why is entrepreneurship exciting? And this is, I think, you know, you might have a different sequence of these points. For me, the most important reason why entrepreneurship is exciting is because it gives you, and you here as the entrepreneur, the opportunity to change lives, right? WhatsApp, for example, I mean, think of it for a minute. Now, the minute you say, I have hundreds of millions of subscribers, right? The world's population itself is about 7-8 billion, right? And to be able to say, oh, okay, maybe 50% of that is my subscriber count, that's a phenomenal statement. And it's so great to see young companies have such a big impact in the way the world operates. To me, that is the most interesting thing about entrepreneurship. You know, I don't know if some of you saw the series on Film Sense, right? One of the points that was made that caught my attention, at least, was this thing about how in Indian cinema, and Indian cinema is the only place where it can happen, where a guy can go from being nothing to being a very successful person in the course of one song, right? And you think, okay, does that happen only in movies? And I think, no, you know, it happens in startups also. You can, on the one hand, have somebody who's had a 40-year career building results little by little. And then people come along like Mark Zuckerberg who say, no, by the time I'm 26, 27, I've done much, much more than most people can. And this is not to put down one group versus the other, but I think achievers like that inspire all of us. It inspires all of us to dream big. And I think that's part of it. It's the first step in actually being able to achieve big. And I think startup or entrepreneurship creates many, many of those inspirational figures that enable all of us to dream big. The third interesting point, you know, whenever you've asked people for career advice, I'm sure you would have heard this, that do what you love and you will be happy, right? You work on something you love, because then whatever you do is not going to feel like work. It will be something you enjoy doing. What better example for that than a startup or entrepreneurship? Because what you're doing is taking something you believe in, something you're passionate about, and converting it into a business, which means 100% of the time you're focused on something that you truly believe in. Next point is, the minute you start to do that, you're pretty much controlling your destiny. You're going to decide what happens with your time, what happens with the journey you're going to take. All of it is in your hands. Business might be successful or not, but you're still controlling the destiny. The other point to keep in mind, again, go back to WhatsApp for a minute. In 2009, WhatsApp did not exist, which means at that point there was nothing. And from that nothing, they managed to create something. And that, to me, is another very exciting, beautiful thing about entrepreneurship. Finally, you create wealth, and not just for yourself as a successful entrepreneur, but for everybody that works with you and for the larger ecosystem. Because invariably what happens is successful entrepreneurs support other entrepreneurs. So they initiate chain reactions which are propagating in nature. So to me, these are six of the reasons why entrepreneurship is very exciting. And it's not a surprise in one way that when we interviewed India's young workforce, which is people between the age of 25 to 32, more than 80% of that workforce said they wanted to be entrepreneurs. Now, this is the great news at one hand, that people are really excited about taking things into their hands and controlling their destiny. But one also starts to wonder, okay, do these guys really think about only the positives, or do they also realize what could possibly go wrong, right? In other words, do they know what they're getting into, right? So let's talk about that a little bit. You know, I think this is maybe the crux of what my talk is going to be about, which is knowing what you're getting into and making sense of that, right? So here are some facts. Until this point, all the slides were super positive, and now I'm going to give you some depressing data. The first data point is that more than 90% of startups fail within 3 years. And I think this is an optimistic number, because some startups continue to file returns even after they have shut business. A more realistic number is that 99% of startups fail within 5 years. And then 50% of them fail within the first year. And less than or about 1% of startups actually end up succeed in raising venture capital. In 2019, for example, in India, 100,000 new companies were started, and about 1,200 new funding rounds were done. So 1,200 divided by 100,000 is about 1.2%. So close to 1% is the success rate in terms of startups raising venture capital. Again, these are at one level depressing numbers, but I think the path to success is by evaluating possible ways to fail and then saying, okay, now I'm going to avoid those ways. So with that intent, let's ask ourselves two questions, right? One, why do so many startups fail? And two, we learn from these failures. You know, it's very, the ideal thing is to say, okay, I will go through the experiment. Maybe I'll fail, I'll learn from my failure, and then I will have to do to succeed. But it's a very expensive experiment to do. So we are better off looking at what other startups have done, how other businesses have succeeded or not succeeded, why did they not succeed, and try and learn from these failures. So I'm going to share with you some examples of companies that have failed. And one thing that is important to remember is that on paper, they all look very capable of succeeding. So it is important to take a very nuanced approach to why or where they did not succeed, right? But before we do that, let's talk about why startups fail. And the good thing is a lot of this is public information. So enough surveys has been done that we can rely on data both in terms of the reasons why startups fail, as well as their relative ranking in terms of likely is this factor going to contribute to failure. So the number one reason why startups fail is because there is no market need for the product or service. And this sounds very counterintuitive, because you think that's common sense, right? You will only build what people need, but it's something that is worth thinking about quite a bit. Because if you have a large company, and this is a point we're going to spend a lot of time on through this talk, if you have a large company, a large marketing team, then you intimately know your customer, or you intimately know your consumer. You know what the consumer wants and why he or she wants that. when you're in a startup, you're in an area of significant uncertainty, that you're taking a huge leap of faith in terms of whether there is a need or not. So that is something we're going to talk about a little more. Let me list the other points, then we will talk about the product market fit. The second reason why startups fail is because they run out of cash. You know, in the world in general, cash is king. And if you have no cash reserves, which is the situation with most startups, then not having cash is pretty much saying that you're out of business. There could be a business model failure. I won't say much at this point, but I have one slide that will tell you what business model failure means and how you protect yourself against it. You don't have the right team. So there's the question of how do I, and I think somebody had this question before the video started, which is how do you go about hiring the team? Who are the right people to bring on board at what time? So we will touch upon that. So that's, if you don't have the right team, that's one possible reason to fail. We will talk about what are ways and means to ensure that you take the right steps. Finally, if you have product problems, and this is not hard to understand, with a startup, you have a runway or a chance or an opportunity to do something once. Maybe if you're very lucky, twice. And if your product doesn't do what it's supposed to do, then it's pretty much curtains at that point. So with that list in mind, what I'm going to do is spend a lot of time talking about the product market fit. I think the product fit is maybe the number one, we know it's the number one reason why startups fail. And I also think it's a reason where it's possible to do a far better job than we do today. By asking ourselves the right questions, it is possible for us to do a better job of knowing whether we have a good product market fit or not. So let me start with this product. You know, this is the Segway. Segway was launched about 2001. And Segway is a electric vehicle. So it's a powered vehicle. It's an electric vehicle that self-balances, right? And when it was launched with the belief that it was going to revolutionize urban commute, right? That people who commute in urban, in the cities, will all transition to the Segway, right? Well, that was the case, and you know, it had so many good things going for it. One is a fantastic innovation. We hadn't seen something like that at that point. Both self-balancing as well as an electric powered vehicle at this form factor was very impressive. It did everything it was advertised to do, so it worked really well. Almost all of the press coverage about it was super positive, and both in terms of funding and in terms of the team, they had all the right people on board, right? So that was where they were in 2001. But if you look at the reality, if you look at today, for example, you know, you go to a mall in Bangalore, it's very likely that you can pay 50 rupees and go for a round in one of these Segways, right? So what was originally imagined to be a urban, something that would revolutionize urban commute, has now been reduced to a curiosity device. So what went wrong, right? That's an important question to ask. And there were two, three factors that contributed to what happened. One, as time went by, people realized it was a product and not a solution. What's the difference between the two? The solution, when we say solution, we also think through all the use cases, what all people are meant to, you know, what all challenges people will face on a day-to-day usage scenario, and giving solutions for those scenarios. So let's say, you know, I'm leaving home, I'm going to commute by metro to work, then from the metro station I have to walk to my workplace. It means that it needs to be portable. It's something that I can dock easily on the metro. I have to have a mechanism to park it. So there's so many, how do I check if it's an electric device? So many different questions around usability, which it appeared were not thought of at all. So that was one big ding for the product. The second one was there was no definition of who it was built for and what need was this product satisfying. For example, the commuter who goes by metro and then walks from the metro station to his or her workplace, did they need this product? Did they say, oh, okay, this is the need that this is satisfying, that walk is very painful for me and I will pay so many dollars or so many rupees to buy this product? None of that analysis was done. So it was almost as if the founders said, let's build a terrific product, and as long as the product is terrific, people will buy it. And that's a very big mistake to make. right? Just because your product is good and the fact that it does what you say it will do does not mean you will have a successful business, right? The other thing to note about the Segway was that until they launched the product was not revealed to anybody, which means nobody had read it, nobody had tried it out. There was no user feedback until the day the product was launched, which means the day it was launched, you suddenly hear 500 different opinions of what all was actually needed to make it user friendly. And at that point, you don't have the ability to go correct those problems, right? So this is the segue where it's a case of a terrific, terrific product, right? Which did not succeed because of product market fit. And for the reasons that I've outlined here, where they didn't ask themselves maybe the questions that they would have been better off asking. Let's talk through another example. What I'm showing here is what is called Satisfries. Satisfries was a product that was introduced in the US by Burger King. So Burger King felt that they were losing market share to McDonald's because of the quality of fries. So there was this theory that McDonald's was so successful because of French fries. And Burger King felt, okay, what I'm going to do is offer this exciting new replacement which will pull my market back. So the key selling point with Satisfries was that it was 20% healthier than regular fries, right? And you can imagine the pitch like this, right? There's a market for Coca-Cola. There is a very decent market for Diet Coke. There's a Diet Coke, there's Coke Zero, Coke One, there's so many, or Pepsi One. There's so many variants of the same soda with significantly reduced calorie counts, which probably led Burger King to believe that, oh, okay, you know, I might be able to succeed with a cheaper way, with a lower calorie variant of the same product. You know, it's sort of interesting because you can't use the phrase healthier junk food, right? To be able to explain what healthier junk food means is very difficult. That's the nature of the problem. It's an oxymoron of the highest order, right? And what they figured out was that customers said, oh, if I want healthy food, I'll go eat somewhere else. I'm not going to eat at Burger King, right? So their understanding of how will customers react to reduced calorie count fries was missing. The other thing was that it was more expensive than regular fries. And again, they expected that people will be willing to pay more for health, which was a mistake. And finally, something that wasn't in their control, a timing problem, where there was belief in the US that potatoes are not good for health. So the total potato consumption itself in the US went down around that period of time. So again, you know, as a idea on paper, when I thought about it, the idea appealed to me. I thought, yeah, if Diet Coke succeeds, maybe low calorie count fries will also succeed. I don't see it. I see Diet Coke in succeeding every region. So many people who swear by Diet Coke. So I would think a zero calorie or a low calorie French fries would have the same impact, but it didn't. Right. So if you know, if I was the one deciding on funding for this idea, I would have probably said yes. And you still see that, oh, even with that, maybe if some of these questions had been asked in more detail, this experiment would have gone a different way. Right. This is the second example. The third one I want to talk to you about is I want to compare two car companies, and it's very interesting. You know, the first one we will look at is the Tesla. And I'm sure you again all heard of Tesla. It's the number one electric car company in the world. And when Tesla was founded, this is Tesla's vision, right? They want to drive the world's transition to sustainable transport. It's an audacious vision. And anytime somebody says, oh, I'm going to change how the world thinks about something, any investor, anybody putting money in that business will be very worried, because it's very difficult to change people's minds. And to be able to say that, no, I'm going to change how they think about sustainable transport, and the way I'm going is by making electric cars a compelling mass market. Electric cars up until that point of time were at best a fancy, right? So many problems when you compare to regular cars. And for somebody to again be so audacious and say, oh, what I'm going to do is take the electric car and I'm going to make it compete against internal combustion engine, as good if not better, that people will line up to buy the Tesla. So this one business option in front of us, right? This is one agency who's, or one team that's, let's say, asked us funding. The other team that's asked us for funding is the Tata Nano. So let's imagine for a minute that we're in 2004, 2005. So on the one hand, we have Tesla that's asking us for funding. On the other hand, we have the Tata Nano. And the Tata Nano's pitch is the following, right? I'm going to appeal to the Indian customer. I know that the Indian customer is status conscious. This is well known. You agree. I also know that one big status symbol for the Indian customer is the car, which is also correct point, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to build an affordable car which will allow a lot of the guys that are on, or a lot of the people that are on two-wheelers or auto to transition to a car. And I'm going to do that by building an affordable car, right? And, you know, when I put them side to side, to me, it seems like the Nano is a far better idea to fund. Because I would think, chances of success are much better. Because it's the, you know, every point that's being made about the Indian customer is right. Only an engineering problem of whether you can build that car at 1 lakh or not. That's how I would have thought about it. And I would have said, oh, with Tesla, it seems so aspirational that it's not given that they will actually succeed, right? So, you know, I don't know which one you guys would have succeed, but if I had been making that decision and I had these proposals in front of me, I would have probably gone with the Tata Nano. And it's interesting because, you know, the Tata Nano doesn't really exist today, and it's a sad story in many ways. And there are good documented reasons for why it did not succeed. Whereas the Tesla has been a phenomenal success. Their market cap is about $130 billion today. And every product they've put out, they've created a cult out of electric cars and have huge fan clubs that are all fans, right? So it's the point I'm trying to make here is it's very interesting how these things play out. And, you know, I obviously have the benefit of insight when I'm looking at these stories. But it is very hard upfront to just look at an idea and say, oh, okay, this idea will succeed or this idea will fail. It's hard to do that. Does that mean we throw our arms up in the air and say, okay, you know, heads or tails is maybe nobody knows what will happen, so let's just give it a shot? Or is there a more methodical way to think about this problem, right? So let's go to that next. And, you know, one of the things that at least I believe in quite a bit is that the hardest problem, hardest thing about anything is learning to ask the right questions. Because if we learn how to ask the right questions, then the answers will automatically follow. Getting the answers is not difficult. It's knowing the right questions to ask that is more difficult. So suppose we were trying to validate the market need. What are the right questions to ask? So the first question that I would ask is, exactly what problem does your product or service solve? Then I would ask, who's your target customer? Followed by, does your target customer believe this problem is worth solving? How do you know that the target customer believes that this problem is worth solving? How much is that target customer willing to pay? And finally, what is the biggest obstacle to success? So if I have to, you know, do our startup all over again, we would probably start with these five questions. And I would try to get very good answers to these five questions. So for a minute again, let's go back in time a little bit. Let's say that, you know, we are starting Ola, right? Again, all of you know what Ola is. I don't need to tell you what they do. So let's say we're all starting this company that's going to do ride sharing. And let's try and answer these questions and see if we have a good product market fit. Let's start with the first question. What problem does your product or service solve? How do we solve offering ride service, right? Who is your target customer? So there are people that use private apps, the people that use autos, then they're at least if you go back, if you agree we're going back in time, then at the time that Ola was launching, there was this very popular service called Meru Cabs, and then there were two, three other variants of Meru's cabs. So this would be the target customer, people that are using all these forms of transport for their commute. Does your target customer believe this problem is worth solving and why, right? Now, you think about it, one of the things, if you again go back in time, the ease of hailing the service. At my house, can I get a cab on demand? Way of transport on demand at a place, whether it's residence or work or wherever I am. Is that possible to get? Do I get a guaranteed level of ride comfort? Is it proven in other markets? So the good thing about a business model or a business idea like this is that it's very easy for you to say, yeah, I truly believe my target customer this problem is worth solving, because I'm solving two very important problems, which is ease of hailing the service and ride comfort, and I know that it's proven in other markets. Then comes the question of how much will they be willing to pay. And the nice thing about a business like this is that it's very easy to get a benchmark. You can say, see, if the guy takes an auto, he's going to pay 13 rupees per kilometer. So if I give him an air-conditioned sedan for 13 rupees a kilometer, there is a no-brainer. Would you travel in an air-conditioned sedan, or would you travel in an auto if the price was the same? So very, very compelling business case, very, very compelling product market fit. And finally, if you ask what is the biggest obstacle to success, I would have come up with, okay, you know, traffic is not predictable in India. So if I say it will take 5 minutes to get your cab, I don't know if I can guarantee 5 minutes. Plus, there is the issue of government regulations and what it takes to be an aggregator of cabs. But on the whole, if I saw a slide like this in front of me while I was evaluating a company, I will feel really, really good about saying, oh, this is a company that I should support. Right? These are not easy questions to answer. And, you know, to be, if I look at our own company, we've had a fair bit of trouble getting good answers to these questions. And part of that is the journey when you try and do something new where proof of prior existence is not there, etc. But that said, if you view this exercise purely as a evaluation of product market fit, I think good answers to these questions will tell you whether you have a good product market fit or not. So if you have a idea in mind, if you're a budding, okay, maybe we're good again. Sorry, I think we had a minor glitch here, and hopefully we've come out of that minor glitch now. What I want to do is continue the conversation around the sources of cash flow. So one of the things that I want to do is list the different sources of money that you can get and rank them in terms of relative levels of importance. So for example, we'll start with paying customers, which in my opinion is the best way to bring money into the company, right? What happens here is, in exchange for the service that you're offering, the customer is giving you cash, right? So looks like we have a slight buffering issue, so bear with me as we just make we resolve it quickly. So like I was saying, the best source of money is a paying customer, where you get money in exchange for the product or the service. And it's the best source of cash coming into the company because, one, it validates the product market fit. You know that if a customer is paying money for what you're doing, then it automatically validates the product market fit. And the second reason is focus. Once you're customer funded, once your customer is driving what you work on, it guarantees focus on the problem, right? So to me, paying customers are the best form of cash coming into the company. Now, say you're working on a product, you're not going to get paying customers from day one. It's worth thinking about what are the other ways and means for you to raise capital, right? One option is grants, and you can get grants from government or from several foundations. Usually that grant is not in exchange for anything, right? In most cases, that grant is used to offer, is offered to build a proof of concept. So I can talk about the Karnataka government because we've benefited from some of the grants. So the Karnataka government runs a program called Elevate, right? Where you can apply with your startup's idea, maybe a basic prototype, for up to 50 lakhs in grant money, right? So it's a very successful program. It's maybe in its third or fourth year. And I would think, you know, as you look at different states, similar programs. The other thing that I can tell you about the Karnataka government, again, what you want is seed funding. So seed funding again can come in, comes from people that are called angel investors. And angel investors are usually high net worth individuals or groups of high net worth individuals. And what they do is give you money against equity, and they usually come into play when you're looking to take the product from a proof of concept to actually launching it in the market, right? The final thing on this table is the institutional investor or the venture capitalist. So let's say you've successfully launched the product, you're now looking to scale the business. That's usually when you go to a venture capitalist. Each of these come in at different stages of the company. And I would again say, you know, if I have to pick one form of cash flow into the company, I would pick the paying customer. So again, if you're looking to start a company, what you should do is think about how quickly you can get into a model where you have paying customers for your product or service. Because having paying customers for your product or service ticks so many boxes, and it also enables any other form of cash flow to come in very easily. So that would be my advice to you guys, to think about paying customers as a primary source of getting money in. So that's this slide. Let's talk about the business models for a bit. And again, this is very, very simple. There are two terms that you need to keep in mind when you talk about the business model. One of them is, it looks like alphabets, I'll tell you what each means. One is CLTV or lifetime value. And the other term is the CAC or customer acquisition cost. Now, what do these terms mean? Customer lifetime value is the net profit attributed to the entire future relationship with the customer. So how much money you're going to earn, so it is profit, not revenue. How much profit you're going to earn from this customer's future relationship, which means that let's say you're going to sell him a product, you have to subtract from the revenue you make, whatever taxes, you also have to subtract the cost of goods and say, okay, that's the net profit I'm going to make from this customer. And compare it against the money you spent in acquiring the customer. So it could be the money spent in marketing, it could be money spent in discount, it could be money spent in offers. All of that put together is the customer acquisition cost. And it's common sense, right? The lifetime value of a customer better be bigger than the acquisition cost. If you're spending more in acquiring a customer than you're earning from him, then you have a failed business model. You're going to keep losing money on every customer, and over time life is going to get very difficult. And what investors generally advise you is that when you calculate the customer lifetime value, calculate it over a period of 12 months. So think of it as, oh, this is the amount of profit I can make from this customer over the next 12 months, and that should be greater than the acquisition cost that I spent for acquiring this customer. So lifetime value over the next 12 months should be better than the acquisition cost. If that holds, then you have a good business model. The last thing, we are not going to really talk about product problems here. The last thing we are going to talk about is the team. Right? So before we, as we talk through the team, let's also talk through the different phases that a startup goes through. So the first phase for me is the build and validate. And this usually goes in loops, right? You build something, try to validate with your early adopters. They give you feedback. You go tweak your product. Then you go back to those customers, be a slightly larger set the second time around, get their feedback, and keep doing this maybe 3-4 times until you feel, okay, now I have a good product that maybe 50-100 people think is the solution. While you're going through this build and validate cycle, the team you want to have is the CEO, who I think should also act as the head of sales. If I have to pick one important responsibility for the CEO of the company, I would say that that responsibility is running sales for the first couple of years. I think it's very, very important for a CEO to be super sales savvy, because again, business is all about generating returns for the shareholder, which comes only if you make money. So it's very, very important for the CEO to embrace that role, right? So you have the CEO who also doubles up as the head of sales. Then you have the product development team, which doubles up as tech marketing. They will be closely engaging with the early adopters in this build validate cycle. And you also have somebody that manages customer experience. So the tech marketing plus customer experience ensures that, one, you're listening to all your early adopters, and that their feedback is making it into subsequent iterations of product. So when you're in this phase, this is the phase before you launch the product, I would think this is how you should staff your team. The next phase after this cycle is the launch phase, where you're ready to launch your product into the market. when you're in the launch phase, you need to add to the team that you already have two key roles. One is the product marketing role, so that you start to put out marketing material around your product, which can still continue to be reasonably technical. And you need field support, because as you launch, you're going to give the product a number of customers, and you need a stable system in place to be able to support those customers. And after you launch, you finally go to the point where you start to scale. This is when you bring in sales and business development, who is going to aggressively look at ways and means to scale. So you don't need sales from day one or business development from day one. It's very important, particularly if you're a startup with limited resources, to be very sensible about who you bring on board when, right? To me, it's one very critical aspect of decision making, right? So this is in terms of content, the slides that I had. What I also wanted to do was leave you with three or four thoughts that I think are important. One, you know, I like Amish Tripathi a lot, the author, and there's something he said that stuck with me, which is about how you use the heart and the mind, right? You know, we often hear, right, you follow your heart, and startups are all about passion. It's about doing what your heart wants. And I think it's very important to acknowledge that and be respectful of that. But very equally important to acknowledge the role of the mind, right? So you use your heart to decide the destination, and you use your mind to plot the journey. So let your heart tell you where you want to go, but let common sense and logic dictate how you go about it. So that's something that I want you guys to keep in mind. The second point, and this again is a sentence you would have all seen in your life. This is from Edison, which is, genius is 1% inspiration, 99% perspiration. And all of us know 1% is not equal to 99%. In some ways, it tells you the relative importance of the idea to the hard work that needs to go behind it. And I'm going to tweak this a little bit and say, startup success is 1% idea and 99% execution, teamwork, perseverance, work ethic, and drive. Those are all the factors that are critical in making sure that you succeed. The third point I want to make, and this is about following your heart, being passionate about what you do, is realizing that there are no failed entrepreneurs. There are only failed businesses. It's possible that you came up with an idea that didn't work. It's possible that we spent years and years of effort and still it didn't really succeed at a business. That's possible. But that doesn't mean we fail as entrepreneurs. There are so many reasons why it's exciting. We went over some of them. And individually, when you go through that journey, you will always find that some of those reasons or some of those things were fulfilled. Right? So again, it's important not to lose heart and remember that we don't fail as entrepreneurs. Maybe we started a business that failed. And the last point to keep in mind is that it's a marathon. It's not a sprint. So you're not trying to be Usain Bolt. You're trying to be, who's it? Kipoche, Kipoge, right? So that's who you're trying to be, the Kenyan marathon record holder. So remember that it's going to take you maybe 7-8 years before you see success, and to have the energy, the patience, the drive, the ethic to be able to withstand that long journey. So with that, I'm going to conclude this talk. Thank you so much for listening to me. I'm now going to look at whatever questions have been submitted and start to answer them. I don't know if I'm actually looking at the right file. Just 1 second. Okay. All right. So let's just hang on 1 second. So let's go with questions now. do's and don'ts for an entrepreneur. We talked about that for a bit. Essential things for starting an entrepreneurship. Again, I think we talked about what's exciting. So hopefully that answers the question. How to start setting up a company to ensure that you have developed products for the market. I think, again, I would say product market fit for me is the number one thing to keep in mind. So start with, if you have patents for some of your ideas, run through the exercise I did on the product market fit and see if you have a compelling business case. That is what I would do. I think that was from Shuddho. Legal procedures which a newborn startup has to follow. So I think, again, that's a slightly long topic to go over here, but most of the registration for a startup can be done over a couple of days. I think the process is quite simple now, and most chartered accountants will be able to assist you through the process of establishing the company. You also get a fair bit of company secretary support, which can support you with any of the regulatory activities needed for the startup. So I would say just search for CAs and company secretaries that help with startup formation, and that should be fine. When should a startup raise funds and should it dilute shares? I think, again, you know, to me, I would flip that question a little bit and say, if when it comes to cash flow, see how quickly you can go to a paying customer model. The more you delay the paying customer model, the more you're going to dilute your startup. Right, and how much you need depends on what you're looking to build, how much it's going to take. So a Tesla like company, for example, we need billions of dollars, whereas a replacement for something that's completely software based might need a much smaller investment. So it's hard to answer when you should raise funds. All I can do is tell you that at a high level, try and be to a paying customer model as quickly as you can. How does one go about launching a product that's never been sold before, something that's new and never heard of before? You know, Rahul, I wish I knew the answer to that question. So that's sort of what we've tried to do as well. Is you know, our product is a cooler that attaches to motorcycle helmets. Now it's more than a cooler, but our first generation was a cooler. And one of the big challenges we faced was establishing customer expectation on what they should benchmark our product against, right? When we say cooler for a helmet, should they compare it to AC in their home? Should they compare it to AC in the car? Should they compare it to a table fan? It becomes a problem, right? To be able to say, okay, this is how I should educate the customer. So what I would say is, rather than how does one go about, I think it's important to accept that we are launching something that nobody's heard of before. You should accept that it's going to take maybe 2-3 generations before people accept your business proposition. So you have to find ways and means to survive for that period of time. Saikat, if you can kindly help us in telling some business plans with less investments. Okay, that I will think about that. I got the question. Private players in... Could entrepreneurship be created? If yes, how? I think there's no formula to entrepreneurship. So it's not a, oh, you go through these. It's not like you can do a course in entrepreneurship and qualify to be a good entrepreneur, right? That's very hard to do. But what you can do is, along the lines that I've outlined today, to ask yourself questions that improve chance of success. How can we start a new venture with minimal investment? I think the answer is, see how quickly you can go to a customer paying model. The sooner you go to a customer paying model, the less investment you need. How entrepreneurship development helps to startups? Again, I think if all the ways in which I can fail, maybe I will be sensible by avoiding all of them. So the more I pay attention to what other people do, understand the problems that they faced and they've overcome those problems, the more likely I am to say, okay, these are the steps to take to succeed, right? How to arrange funds for startup? I think I gave some suggestions there. Planning to launch a hard tech startup related to aeroengineering. I've set a deadline of a year, small scale MVPs. So I think, Shantanu, the point I would make is, one, you should definitely look at what grants are available from the government, from the state government, maybe the central government too, to be able to build some of those MVPs that are that you're talking about? How do you fund the development of some of those MVPs with grant that you can get? And then once you have those MVPs, you take them to maybe road shows, you take them to prospective customers, and start to see that if you can build a business case, that makes it a little more attractive for a seed investor to come in. So that's what I would chart for you. How to arrange funds? I think we talked about funds. How should the product or service be priced such that it's not too costly and is profitable? When should acquisition be considered, and what are the pros and cons? So pricing is a very interesting question, and I think in the Indian context, right, pricing is always relative. So what, when you tell a price, what people almost always do is try to in the at least compare it with another service that they use and think about how much they pay for that service, right? So I think what I would suggest is think about how am I going to justify my to you, right? And I will give you our example, right? One of the things that we faced a challenge with early on was that a lot of our customers were comparing the price of our product to the price of the helmet, right? I felt it was not the right thing because we are a technology product that attaches to the helmet, whereas the helmet is a protective device. There's no point in comparing the two. But the comparison still continued to be stuck in the customer's minds. And what we are now trying is to find ways and means to see how customers can relate our product to the bike rather than to the helmet. Is it possible for us, by changing that association to the bike, to get them to think about our product as a more premium sell, right? So I think when you talk about pricing, the important question for you is to think about, when my customer thinks about the pricing, what is he going to view it in relation to? Once you get a sense of, I think it will become easier to determine the pricing. And in terms of acquisition or IPO, I think it's a question of how much appetite you have, what the offer is like, what your team feels, what your board feels. There are no one right answers to these questions, right? I think it's a call that needs to be made based on your status at that point of time and the collective intelligence of your investors and your leadership team. What are the perspectives of entrepreneurship for a person who is a lecturer in a college? So that's a question from Atla Panda. So what I would say is, there are many, many problems in front of us that are in need of solving, right? Whatever be your vocation, right? And I think you can either say, okay, what I want to do is get more creative education space, and edutech is a very popular area. So there are avenues to think about what might be interesting products in the edutech space if you want to stay in that space. Or look at problems around you and say, okay, I know people who are professors in colleges who continue to run successful businesses outside. And it's not an either or option at all. There are people who do both. There's this company that's run by a friend of mine. He's a professor at IIT Bombay. And he runs this very successful two-wheeler accessory company called Sedamac, right? It's based in Pune, phenomenally successful. And I think the way he went about that was, okay, you start on on a university project with a company, you work through that project, you build solutions for that particular project, and then you see whether there are ideas in that merit incubating a company. Right, so I would say maybe something along that lines. Sedamac is a good inspiration for you to think about. Is probably what I would suggest. Right, startup ideas are being promoted, but at the same time, idea theft is being taken. See, I don't really subscribe to the belief that you have your idea so much. I think, like I said, idea is 1%. The other 99% is hard work, is drive, work ethic, the team, how you convert customers. There's so many other things that are far more important than just the idea. So I've been very open about discussing our idea with just about everybody. I've really not been too worried about, oh, is this person going to steal my idea? I think we have to believe in ourselves. We have to believe that the journey is so hard that just somebody knowing the idea is not going to really matter all that much, right? So this is what I would say. How to take initiative for high initial investment demanding fields, right? I think for areas that need high investment, you also have a lot of justification, right? Justification and a good business plan is what invites investment. So if you're looking, for example, you talked about, and this is Urvesh. Urvesh talked about precast products in the construction industry. I think what you should do is maybe talk to builders like Brigade, Sobha, at least these are the builders in Bangalore, and ask them whether this is really a problem worth solving and how much they would be willing to spend on a solution like this. And what is it that they would like to see before they make an investment, right? So I think to me, it's a step-by-step slow process where you identify prospective customers who are going to benefit from your solution and see how you make them part of your enterprise in the form of investors. So that is, and you know, it is difficult to raise money in general. It takes a lot of convincing. You have to have a lot of patience. But it's the journey we sign up for. So, you know, it's just something we have to do. Success rate of startup is very small. Serious problem for entrepreneurs. I think this is Jaya Vakode. I think it's a question of how you view it in my view, right? I think the likelihood of a business succeeding is only 1%. Is it low? Yeah, it is very low. But it's still the fact that many people still take it is a sign of the belief that those successes can alter the world in a very significant way, right? So we shouldn't look at just the percentage. You look at the percentage multiplied by the impact, right? I mean, you think about, you know, think about what the world will be like without WhatsApp, without Facebook, without Instagram, without Tesla, without Apple, without Microsoft, right? All of these are even Apple is maybe 40 years old, but they still operate like a startup, and some of the greatest products have come out of that startup like thinking, right? So I wouldn't personally be put off by that low percentage of success. It's something that you accept, and then you work towards seeing how you put yourself within that 1%. What can you do to be in that 1% succeed or whose business succeeds and can contribute to impacting lives for many people and enabling a number of other entrepreneurs? How can the concept of entrepreneurship from academic institutions? This is Sujata from Bangalore. Sujata, what I would say is IIT Bombay maybe is a very good example of an academic institution can do to kickstart startups. So they have this incubation center called SIGN. IIT Madras has had a fair bit of success with their research park where again they incubate startups. So I think we have examples of academic institutions demonstrating good startup success. For example, a company like Aether, which is electric scooters, came out of IIT Madras. Companies like housing.com, Idea Forge, they all came out of IIT Bombay. So I think we do have several examples of companies that have been successfully incubated in academic institutions. So I would point you in the direction of IIT Bombay or IIT Madras. Spend time with SIGN or the incubation or the research park in IITM and understand from them what it is they do and encourage entrepreneurship within the academic institution. That's the question list I had. Once again, thank you so much for being on this episode with me. I hope you all enjoyed it. Thank you.